welcome to a very special holiday edition of PodCRASH with me. It's very special because, well, I'm inviting you into my home. That's right. I'm recording the wraparounds for this special holiday, Christmas, Kwanzaa, Hanukkah, whatever you call it, edition. Recording it at my very own holiday party. Many friends in attendance. Some business associates. Although whenever I work with someone, I usually end up being their friend. It makes working with them so much easier when you kind of like each other, you know? It's not all about business. It's also about having fun. And it's that time of year where you reflect and hopefully you're grateful for all that you have in your life. I feel extremely lucky. Most of my job involves me being an idiot on television. So I feel incredibly grateful to have that kind of job. And I hope I've brought some joy into your life. Maybe made you smile or laugh at some point. I do want to thank you for not sending me a Christmas card. And I'll explain to you why. I'm happy you did not send me a Christmas card. You would have been wasting a lot of paper. Probably would have wasted a lot of money because, honestly, I don't know all of you and I would have looked at your name and not recognized it. But I would have been grateful and thankful that you sent it, but I'm happy that you didn't. I think it's very environmentally sound. I'm happy to take your holiday wishes via email or Twitter, from the digital realm. Something that doesn't, you know, cost money or use valuable resources. I also want to thank members of my family for also not sending Christmas cards. I don't take it personal at all. I think that that was the smart thing to do. I didn't send you a Christmas card, so why should you send me a Christmas card? And anyways, we're supposed to be doing giftless Christmas, right? You know, except for the little kids in the family. We're supposed to be doing the giftless Christmas. I think we should stick with that. And also, if you're a family member and you're listening to this, please discontinue listening to this. It's going to be kind of embarrassing and awkward the next time I see you, and I'm going to think back at things I said in past editions of PodCRASH, and I'm going to be extremely embarrassed. I'm going to guess that you're going to be pretty embarrassed, too. And if you're not embarrassed, you're probably going to have a lot of questions. And I'm going to be very evasive. And then we might get in a fight. It'll escalate. We're screaming at each other. I've run out of the house. We're not even speaking to each other. Which means you shouldn't send me a Christmas card. And you shouldn't be listening to this podcast. I also want to thank some of my exes who actually sent Christmas cards. I have exes who still send me Christmas cards. That's sweet. But I think mostly I appreciate the exes who didn't send Christmas cards, because who wants that kind of reminder around the holidays? You know, you're with your significant other, you've got past significant others sending you cards, and then it's extremely awkward. Then you have to explain to the current significant other, why are you getting these cards from your ex-girlfriend? Why are these arriving in the mail? How do they have your address? I think it's about honesty. If I'm getting a card from an ex and I keep it out there, hey, I want you to know there's nothing going on. That's why this card is out here, see? It's just sort of amongst all the other cards. You know, I think that's better. It's better than you know, getting some secretive text or email. I'd rather up front get this crap that I intend to throw away later. So I appreciate all of you for tuning in and to making PodCRASH with me your podcast of choice in 2011. Although we only really did seven or eight episodes or so. We got a whole bunch banked, so trust me, 2012 is going to be the year of the PodCRASH. There are so many fun upcoming appearances. I can't even tell you what they are. and incredible revelations. You're not going to believe what you're going to hear on this podcast. But I really wanted to speak to all of you first. And thank you for listening, and hope you'll continue to listen. And hope that you tell your friends to listen. And I hope that you go to iTunes, and when you post a review, don't say anything too mean. I'm not asking you to kiss my ass, but would it be too much to click on the 5-star and say, "Hey, great, Chris. Love what you're doing. Love the PodCRASH. Keep it up." And if you have a computer that has multiple iTunes accounts, sign into all of those and then also post positive comments with 5-star reviews. That would help me a lot. Anyways, join me, will you, for a very special Christmas edition of PodCRASH with me. Yeah! Welcome to PodCRASH with that Chris Gore. I am that Chris Gore, and you're actually crashing my holiday party. Fuck that holiday party. This is a Christmas party. I am wearing my Christmas sweater, which if you look online, if you Google Chris Gore holiday sweater or Chris Gore Christmas sweater, you will see what I'm wearing. I take no responsibility for that. Sean.
Yeah, what?
Sean, my producer, thought it would be a good idea. Hey, let's record the wraparounds for the Christmas show at your Christmas party. Good idea, Sean.
Because I love those shows when you can barely hear people in the background and everything, and you're just like, oh, wait, who is that? I don't know, because it sounds so distorted and shitty.
What's funny is there are people here from podcasts. This is like the podcast of Christmas past.
Is it really?
Adam Spiegelman is here.
I noticed him, yeah.
There are other people here from the land of podcasts. Sandra Doherty's here from Sex Nerd.
Here's the thing,
Sandra. Like, I love Sex Nerd Sandra's podcast.
Can I say who
I want to be in her podcast? Where is she? I'm gonna go grab her.
Oh, okay.
You have to fill time.
Well, okay, because I was just gonna mention that there's folks that come to the at this party.
And I have a bite of rum cake. It's so good.
I often don't know. Oh, hi.
Hi, Aaron Gibson. Wait, are they seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, I can't hear them.
Come on.
Please.
Hi.
What does Michelle Bachman think of this?
Michelle Bachman? What does she think of this? Michelle Bachman loves this party. Wow. Michelle Bachman couldn't have more fun here.
Well, I mean, clearly there's rum cake involved, so.
Oh, exactly. Michelle Bachman loves rum cake, pornography, and everything that Tim Burton's ever done. So this house is perfect for it.
It is fantabulous.
Happy holidays, everyone. Don't get drunk and mad at your parents when you go home.
Oh, my God. Michelle Bachman, I love your hair. I mean, Aaron Gibson as Michelle Bachman, I love your hair also. I did actually not know that was you in those Funny or Die videos.
But now you put it all together. And it's
I put
exciting.
It all together. Oh, my God. You know what's? I feel so guilty I jerked off to those.
Oh, well, she's a beautiful woman.
I don't know. She's kind of hot in a milfy way. What do you think about that?
Oh, I agree with you 100%.
Yes. Yeah. So you kept the wig.
Crazy. I have the wig, yeah.
Don't get rid of the wig. Aaron, bye.
Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy
Merry
Kwanzaa.
Christmas. Yes, yes. And whatever holidays we invent in the future.
Well,
hi. Yes, you will. Hi. And guess what? Guess who else is here? Adam Spiegelman from Proudly Resents is here. It's like a podcast
Chris
from Christmas past.
Chris Gore. Here's what you're missing from Christmas past.
I have one question for you, Adam Spiegelman. Who was your favorite guest of 2011 on your podcast?
It's hard to say. There's so many. Wow, I would have to say... Oh, Chris Gore, of course. Yeah.
That's okay.
No,
you don't have to say that. Okay. I would actually, you should pick, like, do what I always do.
Okay, what do you pick?
Use the method I use to approve friend requests on Facebook. If she's hot, just say confirm.
Yeah. But sometimes you want to check to see who else they're friends with, and then they're hot, and you're like, I don't know. Maybe it's a scam, but I'll just do it anyway.
Speaking of hot, you know who's right over here is what? Nikki Hunter. From Playboy Radio, soon-to-be star of Fetishville, Nikki Hunter. Say hello.
Hey, I'm here for the Chris Gore holiday orgy party. Am I in the right place?
Yes, but there are too many clothes. Oh, my God. Now I'm blushing. You caught me now.
Did I get the wrong invitation, Chris?
No, it's good.
Is that tomorrow night?
Yes, tomorrow night will be that.
Chris, what are you talking about? There's a bowl of keys outside here.
Okay, so, Nikki...
And trench coats.
Nikki, you're on Playboy Radio on Sirius XM.
I am.
You should tell people about that show, because I've been on that show twice now. Thank you so much for having me as a guest.
You're always awesome to have, and you're such a good sport about it, too, because we ask you all kinds of sexual questions. It is Playboy Radio, and you actually answer them, which is amazing.
Well, the worst part is you are always doing things that are so incredibly distracting.
Me? It wasn't me that was pulling out the Hooters.
Yeah, it was you and Debbie Diamond.
Yeah, but there was some spanking going on. I won't imply whose butt was spanked, but yeah.
Yes, and now Santa would like to talk to... We should bring over some other people from the... Tom! Here's Sandra. If you listen, one of my favorite podcasts, which I've never been on, is the Sex Nerd Sandra podcast. And Sandra's
here. You're trying to guilt me right now.
A little bit. We've hung out, we've talked online, but I've never been on your podcast.
Well, tonight we have shared some deep memories.
I actually told you some very personal things. Now I'm embarrassed, because now the audience knows about this.
I'm very excited. No, you have some very interesting techniques. I need you on the podcast now.
You should see what I can do with a Swiffer Duster. But you'll have to listen to Sex Nerd Sandra's podcast to find out about Swiffer Duster.
This man can clean, and when I say clean, I mean something else.
Oh, my God. Yes, you should listen to the podcast. Plug your Twitter and all that.
At Sex Nerd Sandra with an A. You can check me out in the sexuality section of iTunes. Sex Nerd Sandra, it's what I do. Just Google me. .com stuff.
It's educational. Yeah. I feel like you have a term that you use throughout the show.
Yes.
Sex positive. And
yes.
I feel that's good.
Because if you're not sex positive, what are you, sex neutral? Most likely you're sex negative.
Christmas, Santa, stockings, anal, I don't know what we're doing. Thank you for coming. Well, I hope to be on your show at some point. But thank you for coming to the party.
In the new year. Let's enjoy the holiday season.
Of course.
Yes, 2012.
Of course.
High five.
Yeah!
Yeah!
Tom has one of the coolest stand-up
penises?
Shows.
Oh, stand-up
and
show,
penises.
Yes.
Stand-up shows in L.A. You've allowed me to do the stand-up on your show.
I'm
shocked.
Allowed you?
How did I do?
You did great. Are you
really
kidding?
Did I do okay?
Yes. I was talking to somebody else at your party here, and they said, like, it's sad that they kind of rush you sometimes.
Right. I had, like, all these cards, and I'm like, do I tell that story? Do I tell that? I don't know. You know how it is. You do stand-up.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, you have to
do... Like, here's that joke. Don't tell that one.
Well, I'm more
like,
of a...
Fuck it.
I'm more of a, like, I'm just going to tell them all. Like,
right.
Because I only have three or four when I go up, so, like, I just, you know, hopefully they'll laugh. But no, the show's called Sweet Sweet Stand Up. It's at M Bar, and in Hollywood.
M Bar.
Yeah, it's a fun place. It's a good venue. It's great.
Great venue.
It's the deep red velvet plush. It's like it's like Liberace's wet dream. Like it's just all gorgeous.
It's classy old Hollywood.
It is, and yet, like the place that what it was before Joe Reynolds opened it. It was like a old Romanian restaurant. Like, and he kept that theme there and just added a few, you know, new things.
Well, I got to tell you something, Tom. I was on a podcast where we talked about Christmas movies.
Oh.
And one of my favorite Christmas movies, you will not believe this.
Okay.
One of my favorite Christmas movies, which I don't mention on this show, because I crashed, I was on a podcast called Popcorn Mafia, hosted by Grae Drake.
Okay.
And she's here. We'll talk to Grae later. We were talking about Christmas movies. I didn't mention this on the show, so I want to mention this. What would Jesus buy?
And it is one of my favorite. It's a Christmas movie that is also a documentary.
I think I've seen clips of that.
It's awesome. It's about consumerism, and it's about this preacher who goes around to like Disney stores.
I've seen it.
He crashes them, and yes. he sings these perverted, like Christmas carols that are all about just us buying too much crap.
He was all over the Occupy movement, too.
We should move on to a giftless Christmas. I'm all about the giftless Christmas.
I
disagree.
I like giving gifts to family.
With exception. Okay, children are exempt.
I couldn't break my daughter's heart.
Significant others, exempt.
Yeah.
But everyone else, I mean, who gives a shit if you give me a candle? I don't need... Tom, I don't need your candle.
I don't want to give you my candle in any shape or form. I have a... Speaking of...
Yo, that would be... If you just let that pause, you don't want to give me the candle.
I don't want to give you the candle.
That is... We should get t-shirts that say, not giving you the candle.
Not giving you the candle. No candles from me.
Yeah, but like... Yeah, so I just feel like we all... We're buying all this crap. Do we really need it? Do we need more stuff?
I once broke up with a girl the day after Christmas. And on Christmas, like, I already knew I was going to break up with her, but I didn't want to break up with her on Christmas. So I got her the worst gift. Like, I got her picture frames without any pictures in it.
Oh, my God.
Like,
that's great.
Yeah, the next day, she goes, I knew this picture. Like, I knew that's what was happening. I knew it.
So we got to introduce Popcorn Mafia. Grae Drake is the host. Alonso Duralde. I love to say his name. Who is the author of one of my favorite books, Have Yourself a Movie Little Christmas, an awesome book about Christmas movies. I was on Grae's podcast, and here it is for your listening pleasure. Merry Christmas.
Welcome to This Thing of Ours, the Popcorn Mafia. A movie program for people who love movies, hosted by Grae Legs Drake. Each week, a new special guest joins the crew, and they're going to have a sit-down to review two movies. They'll say whatever they want. So if you don't like spoilers, then forget about it. So sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of the Popcorn Mafia.
Hello, my darlings. Are your bells jingling? It's your host, Grae Drake, and this is episode 182 of the Popcorn Mafia. And I am super duper just over the moon in a sleigh jazzed for the show.
And look who's here.
Oh, my God.
Late.
Hey, gang.
It's Chris Gore. Put on the headphones, baby.
I was inspired by Marilyn Monroe, who was actually famously always late.
So I learned in my week with Marilyn.
That's true.
That's where I learned it too.
But she brought
from a book.
She brought a little more to the table, as they say.
Pull up a seat. Make yourself comfortable.
Oh, I sure will.
I've already introduced people to you.
You've already introduced me, and I'm not. Wait, am I on? Am I on?
Oh, you're on. You're on. Now that's the volume for your headset, so you can make it nice and loud.
You sound awesome.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Chris Gore.
Oh,
welcome to the Popcorn Mafia.
Even better when you whisper. Merry Christmas, John.
Merry Christmas, Yoko.
Now, and what we haven't talked about yet is actually, Chris, how you and I met, which is...
We should talk about that.
We should talk about that, because recently I found myself on the next-to-impossible-to-board flight to New Zealand.
Strangers on a plane.
It was, and that is a very long flight. It's like 13 and a half hours, I want to say. And so... My side of the story is that I barely got on the goddamn plane because they kept switching shit around, and it was like they were all over the place, and I was furious walking down the walkway. I finally sit down, and I have the only row that's empty, and I was like, fuck yeah. So I put my Swedish fish on that seat. I put everything that was personal on that seat.
What airline does one fly to New Zealand?
This one was Qantas, and they should have flown us Air New Zealand. Because
I would have renamed them Qantas because of the way that they... Because it was the worst. In fact, I took a picture of the meal on the flight because I wanted to. I never tweeted this, but it was like, what's the exact opposite of my compliments to the chef? It was the worst. And that's such a cliche.
Ask the chef to step outside.
Yeah. Oh my God, it was terrible. But what's great was the Swedish fish matched your hair.
Oh.
Oddly.
Hmm.
But so, you were so polite, and the thing that I noticed was, hopefully you were the most polite person I may have encountered randomly on a flight in a decade, because nobody says excuse me when they want to get. I had the aisle seat. You had the.
I was on the window,
and you said excuse me, and I thought I haven't heard that in years. Usually people say I gotta go. I gotta get out. Move. Yeah, exactly. They're assholes. But you were so polite. I'm like, oh my god, I'm polite. I like to. I feel guilty putting my seat back I rarely do it.
I know,
rarely
me
put
too.
My seat back.
Well, and so I, you know, you walk down the aisle, and I was like, please go sit somewhere else. Please sit somewhere else. So my Swedish fish can have somewhere to sit. Please, 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 don't come to the seat. And then you did, and I was like, oh. And then, like an asshole, I couldn't even like gather all my stuff properly. You were really nice about it. And so I was like, ugh, this is horrible. I can't ever look this person in the face again. And it took us like 12 hours of the 13 to figure out.
No, here's what we did. We politely ignored each other the entire flight.
We did. We wasped each other.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it was finally you pulled out an itinerary, and I was being the sly, crafty dog that I am. I glanced over. See, now you thought that I was just watching The Office, but right. I wasn't. I was spying on you. And I saw that you had Fox in the corner of your itinerary, and I went, oh, fuck, we're going to the same place.
What are the odds?
And halfway through the flight, I thought to myself, wouldn't it just be a lark if we actually were going to the same place? No, that couldn't possibly happen in an airplane full of people, which is how I sound in my head.
And then we spent like the last maybe 20 minutes of the flight actually conversing.
Right. And it worked out. It went very well. We missed a flight together. We bonded. It was fantastic.
It was actually really fun missing the flight and complaining about the previous flight.
And we had to walk like a mile. Ugh. It was pretty wild. New Zealand is a wild place, we learned.
And by wild, we mean boring. It was there's a lot of land there. Let's just say there's a lot of undeveloped land in New Zealand. When the apocalypse hits, I'm going there to build a house.
Go to New Zealand. It's perfect. Well,
like an Until the End of the World. Or is that Australia? I forget. It's one of those.
Oh, I think it. I don't think anyone really talks about New Zealand except Peter Jackson. But they should, and they should. Well, we were flying in, and I was just really excited because when you fly in, next to the plane is a big Hollywood-esque sign on the hill that says all blacks. And I was like, yay, reverse racism. But it was really just a rugby thing.
Which is odd because it's a country pretty much of all white people.
It is. It's ironic from the start.
So it's the Canada of the Southern Hemisphere?
More or less.
Mm. It's like Canada, but more dull.
And no French.
Less
thank
to
God.
Do. Less to do.
Much less. Mm. So more so, not the same amount of sweaters, however.
We tried because we asked some locals, like, hey, so, like, what's the seedy underground? Where's the club scene in
Wellington?
Hold
on a second. Correction, Chris. You asked
them.
Okay,
I asked. Where's the sort of underground, the sort of cool? I want to know the place.
Grae was happy to stay in the hotel.
Somewhere I might get stabbed. I just like that sense of impending danger, the adrenaline that goes with the light beer I'll be drinking.
And they were all, their answer was, oh, yeah, there's some bars down the street. Like, there was nothing.
Well, we had two girls kill one of their mothers back in the 50s. Perhaps you saw heavenly creatures. That was the worst accent ever. I don't know.
It's okay. It's only slightly worse than mine.
But what was great was learning, we learned a whole bunch of different terms, local terms. The Australian one I remember the best was chin rest, which is known in the U.S. as your taint.
All right. So this is Sean, the producer of PodCRASH. Normally this is PodCRASH with that Chris Gore. We're at Chris Gore's holiday party. And Chris Gore is out gallivanting and glad-handing and glad-avanting. And I have no idea when he'll be back to actually help crash the show properly. So let's take in some Christmas spirit at Gore Walker Ranch, if you will. Hear those jingling bells. Or don't. They're in my head.
My interests are very diverse, from crafting to politics.
To dirty sweaters.
Yes, to dirty Christmas sweaters.
I don't mean dirty like they're filthy. I mean dirty like they show Santa's cock on them.
Yeah, my girlfriend and I last year went to an ugly holiday sweater party, and we wore these we wore these sweaters. And mine, if you look, it's just like Santa looks very surprised. If you lower your field of vision, you see that Santa's getting blown by a female elf. And then my girlfriend, who she happens to be Asian, she's half Chinese, her green sweater the top half is covered all in
snowflakes.
Delightful snowflakes.
Beautiful.
If you lower your field of vision, you notice that Santa is getting a hand job from an Asian masseuse, and the jizz is the snowflakes is jizz,
now,
I guess.
Now, did you find these or did you have them made?
I had them specially made. I'll show you, Alonso.
He had them made, and the thing is,
which is perfect on a podcast.
I hate Etsy.
I love Etsy.
Well, the thing is that the thing that I find really sweet about the whole thing is that Chris has absolutely found his proper mate. For sure.
It would appear.
Asian woman who is as hot as his girlfriend is, who is smart enough and has a good enough sense of humor to wear that goddamn shirt, is truly the woman that he should cling to for dear life for the rest of his.
See how much longer she can tolerate me.
All I object to on your sweater is the deep V.
Yes, V-neck. Oh, my God. I love it.
That's disgusting.
So we were talking about Eyes Wide Shut, which, by the way, is Alonzo's suggestion from his book, Have Yourself a Movie Little Christmas, available on Amazon. And
I brought you a copy, Mr. Gore.
Oh, thank you.
Did you bring me a copy of your book?
Yes, I did.
Yes!
Right here.
It's a book trading party. I didn't bring you guys anything except cookies.
Hey, we got smart water.
Do.
Yay! Woohoo! Thank you. Ooh, Chris Gore's Ultimate Film Festival Survival Guide.
Well, first of all, Eyes Wide Shut.
Keep it next to my bed. Eyes Wide Shut is what we're talking about.
I have to ask you, Alonzo, are you talking about the European version or the U.S. version?
According to your book...
They're both Christmassy.
Well, but the European version, I mean, famously, they in the U.S. version, they added sort of digitally added these shadowy figures to cover up the sex in the sex orgy because... Yes. That would be the ultimate Christmas party. I mean, that's great. Relatives, blah, blah, blah.
Well, right.
But you know what? That is a straight people's idea of what an orgy is.
Tell us the gay version just to give me some new ideas.
Well, there would be snacks for one thing.
What? Yes. If you ever see these sex party websites, they always say buffet. What is the attraction of a buffet?
Well, look.
Some sort of orgy.
Let's just say my husband... After the act, wants a cheeseburger, you know.
Because you've done it correctly, obviously.
He is hungry afterwards, so some people build an appetite. You know?
Listen, you are the cutest couple whenever I see the two of you at screenings and stuff.
I know.
And you guys are so awesome.
It's hard to get past the adorableness.
Oh, shut up.
It's true, especially when you see Alonso, like, put his hand on Dave's knee and Dave hits his hand. It's super cute.
That is so cute.
Anyway, but there are some people who, like, you know, the act makes them hungry and you don't want them leaving, you know, for a snack and then they might not come back. You put the buffet out of the
order. What if they have an aversion to dairy? You don't want them, you know.
You need to be very clear, obviously, like, because some folks might have nut allergies. Insert joke here. You know, but I think a nice spread is okay. This is getting nice. Anyway,
but you didn't even talk about the buffet with having me.
Here's what I've learned in my many years of doing it is that you should always do it on an empty stomach because then you've done it correctly.
Because whatever's in there is going to get all roiled up.
Well, it's true. And if you've ever had a moment, because I mean, generally
you might be turning upside down at some point.
You might be. And I always think it's gross when you hear the food sloshing in your stomach when you're just getting fucking railed. And that's not okay.
Unless you're into that sort of thing, we don't judge. But I'm inclined to agree
with
you.
The food sloshing is not hot. You have to yell that much louder to cover it up.
The reason that the orgy in Eyes Wide Shut is a straight people orgy because it's so like charmless and like guilty and secretive.
And weird. Now, what I was surprised about. Now, I first saw this film in 97. Con mi padre.
Oh, my God.
99.
Oh, yeah, that's right. 99. Con mi padre. And so my dad and I have seen a series of awkward films together, so we're kind of past that now. I mean, like, I took him to Black Snake Moan, for God's sake. Oh, and within the first 15 minutes, I looked at him, and I'm like, we did it again. Like, way to go us. I mean, he showed me Heavy Metal. It's all weird. It's weird. But So we sat through the movie, and what I remembered from the film was that it wasn't sexy. It was a lot of people just yammering on and on and on, generally under the influence of some kind of drug or alcohol. And then it was just very a lot of Christmas trees everywhere. That's all I remembered from the film. So I was really excited to see it again, because what is it now, 12 years later?
Yeah.
And I still have the same impression after seeing it for the second time.
Yeah, it's one of those Kubrick films, because everybody, you know, praises Kubrick for being the type of director who, well, you need to see his movies several times to see the deeper meaning. And I mean, I watched 2001 recently. I'll go on a tear with that. That thing is just – there's so much going on in that.
It's amazing, yeah.
Love that movie. Eyes Wide Shut is – definitely one of the films that fits into the more you watch it, doesn't get better or more meaningful. And the thing is it is sort of this sort of perfect vision of this sex party / orgy, because all of the people are too good looking. They're way too good looking and way too the body types are out of central casting for the hottest models in Europe. So
hottest.
which is great, because I get the suspicion that maybe, and this doesn't just come from his roots having been in Lolita. I think that Kubrick's a bit of a perv, just a bit of a perv. I admire that. I admire that in a film director, because...
You sense a kinship?
Yeah, well, yes, of course. I mean, look, I am one that will not complain about gratuitous nudity. I think you're a real artist if you can, weave nudity into the plot. There's a
right.
very good story reason for it, but...
Like Showgirls.
Yeah, but it's like one of those things where my girlfriend had a really interesting comment recently, where she said that, like, George Lucas, if you look at the Star Wars prequels, he looks like a director that doesn't want to fuck. He's not interested in fucking. But then you look at James Cameron, and you look at James and Avatar and the films, the projects he's taken on, he's like a director that really still wants to fuck. And it's just...
And other species, too.
Yeah. Exactly, exactly.
And you get, all of a sudden, you get why Catherine Bigelow looks so jilted whenever she talks about him.
But I think that Kubrick, up until his death, was just obsessed with that kind of thing. And then maybe it was something that he was interested in that world. I don't know. I really just think Tom Cruise is just miscast in that movie. He just stands out. It's
weird. It's weird. It's weird how it comes off. Now, you're in your book, something I noticed, it's not a review book. You're not reviewing the films. You're talking about them in the context of Christmas, and it's a very positive book.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm sort of de facto reviewing it in that I put in movies pretty much that I like and that I would think that other people should see.
Well, so you need to stand up for Eyes Wide Shut, because I thought you were very kind to it
description,
and I was like, what?
I think it's a movie that holds up. I mean, I remember I think it was the first movie that I took Dave to see at the Chinese when we had first moved back here in 99.
Oh.
And he had never been. And we went on like the 10 a.m. show Friday morning, and the lines down the block. And he's like, who are all these people? And I'm like, they're screenwriters. They don't have jobs. They can come to the 10 a.m. show on a Friday.
Hollywood.
And at the time, I just remember thinking it was like I was knocked out by Nicole Kidman, who at that point I had never really taken particularly seriously as an actress except for Dead Calm, maybe.
It was a good movie.
I was really like, oh, okay, she's really good in this. She knocks this thing out. And for me, the more that I see it as the years go by, I find the comedy more, because it's kind of like a reverse sex farce in that the lead guy can't get laid no matter how hard he tries.
That's great,
And so it's about his kind of like trying to cope with these revelations about his marriage and stuff, and being so impotent about it, and so like just can't close the deal, and this whole going to the orgy and getting caught at the orgy and kicked out at the orgy, and I just think it's that whole scene
with prostitute as HIV.
Yeah, the whole scene with like Alan Cumming flirting with him. I think this is a nutty movie. I find it really entertaining, and I just love the fact that you've got this very kind of dark story about a marriage falling apart and secret mistresses and this and that, and it's all at Christmas time.
Okay, I love that you said that, because I love when movie reviews are one thing, and anybody can render an opinion, and with the internet everything's democratized. What I love is when someone like yourself will offer a new way for me to see that movie. I love that, and so now I'm really gonna enjoy your book. And I'm not just giving you an audio HJ. What I'm saying is, I love that. The thing that struck me and what bothered me about the film is I just thought that Tom Cruise was a pussy. Because, oh my God, his wife has fantasies about having a gangbang. Big fucking deal. I feel like today, like especially thanks to the internet, every woman over the age of 18 knows, well, younger, knows everything that's possible. I mean, it's really, and I don't think it's a stretch that a woman would have that kind of fantasy. I don't think it's, so what I'm saying is he's so overreacting to his wife just being a sexual female. So I think he's kind of a wuss. Right, he's intimidated by it.
But the movie's not endorsing him being a wuss about it. The movie is like, can you believe this guy? And that's why the last line
is so, what I was like, can you believe this guy?
That's why the last line is so, sort of like bring it all home, you know.
Let's fuck.
Yeah. Spoiler.
Fucking never goes out of style. Timeless. There are a few things about this movie that I found newly hilarious.
What's that?
The first of which being that Tom Cruise flashes his goddamn doctor's license more than a sheriff does.
No, I'm a doctor is like a running gag in this
movie.
It
absolutely is. It's like every single place he goes, he's doing inappropriate things, like pushing the bell at a costume rental store at approximately 1:30 in the morning and going, I'm a doctor. It's totally fine. And the guy's like, yeah, okay, cool. You're his doctor. It's like, oh, you guys, you should be the most afraid of doctors. Like, he knows how to use these tools effectively. Don't let him inside. What the fuck is wrong with everyone in this movie? That was the most shocking.
I mean, even the scene with, like, the frat boys calling him a faggot and stuff. I mean, like, it's all of a piece of this guy just, like, not coping and not, like, being able to deliver on what is apparently going on all around him. He is surrounded by licentiousness and just cannot get in on it, you know? And yeah. that's the joke.
I love that you said licentiousness. I love that. Thank you. I love it.
I'm HJing you back.
Yeah! Yay, Christmas HJ!
Double HJ!
For that's the just, holiday.
That's just how we roll here on the Popcorn Mafia Christmas.
Here's what I love is... in order to get himself into this sex orgy party club thing, he has to use the word fidelio.
Right.
Fidelio, which sounds like it's sort of a mix between fellatio and fidelity. Is that, I mean, am I wrong?
No, you mentioned that in the book.
It is one of my fun facts. Fidelio is a Beethoven opera about, I think it's a woman who has to disguise herself as a guard to get her lover out of prison. So it's all about the whole mistaken identity, pretending to be something else.
Also,
there's not a wasted beat in a Kubrick movie. Right. It all means something.
Well, and that's the whole thing feels so, pardon the phrase, stiff to me, that it was peculiar because I didn't actually really feel like the actors' performances were that great. It was, and then I just like I didn't think the sex was sexy at all. I mean, in the DVD version now on Blu-ray.
Well, you look at the European version. You can actually find on YouTube. You can actually find that unedited sort of. That's a sex orgy that with the European version without the shadow.
That's how it
it's
lives.
It's better. It's better.
It is. Well, that's how it lives now on DVDs.
Oh, really? Did they finally release the Blu-ray?
Okay, uncut version or
so
whatever.
So the Blu-ray has that. And so actually it was perfect timing because that's just when my boyfriend walked in the door. And he knew that I was watching the film, but I was like, oh, honey, it's a good part.
Oh, my God.
He's like, he sits down and he's like, I don't remember this being the good part. And so we're watching the sex and I was like, oh, yeah, this kind of bums me out. Like, well, we're definitely
it's
not
very clinical.
Be...
It's very clinical.
Well, everything in a Kubrick movie.
It didn't make
movie,
me want to do it at all.
Everything in a Kubrick movie is like the 800th take. You know, so by that point, everybody's just like.
Just like, oh my God, already. Ugh. Ever feel that way sometimes, you guys?
No.
Oh, just. End
Are we
it
still
already.
Here?
Jesus. God. Rudy Ray Moore once in a Q&A, I will never forget, he said, he goes. He did, actually, this it wasn't even prompted. No one
there
asked
was, there
him.
Was no cue.
Yeah, no one asked him a cue. He just ate. And he was like, ladies, he goes, if you're done making love to your man and he wants to go take a run around the block, you ain't done it right. He should be asleep. Thank you. And that was it. That was his, like, words of wisdom.
Oh, my God.
I know.
Thanks, Dolomite.
It was fantastic. Right in the halls of the great historic Egyptian, I got an amazing sex tip that I've carried with me for the rest of my life.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. So every time that I'm done having sex, is the little pillow talk cuddle happens, and I'm like, do you feel like taking a run around the block? And the answer is always no. And then I go, oh, thank
God. My work here is done.
Thank God. Thank God, honey. I don't know why I just ran. Okay, let's move on. I actually started to see the film as it went on, as like the Christmas trees that are just omnipresent in this world are they're emitting fumes that are making everyone sexual deviants. Because there's so many Christmas trees in this movie. It's like cramming Christmas down your throat. Yeah, worse than that creepy uncle.
It's beautiful because they're the source of all the lighting.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, like, just from the cinematography standpoint, it's a beautiful film. You can't...
When people say, why is that a Christmas movie? I'm like, watch any 30 seconds of it and tell me why it's a Christmas movie.
Literally, every single time they walk into a room... Every single time there's a Christmas tree.
Yeah.
Even the prostitute
has a nice little treat to tabletop version. Yeah. You know, I love when they walk into Sidney Pollack's big party and there's that whole wall behind the staircase of all the lights and stuff. That's just gorgeous.
His whole mansion is stunning with those hanging lights.
Yeah. Although I will say that Kubrick's refusal to film in the United States shows a little in this one, because actual New York at Christmas time is a lot more lushly Christmassy than fake Christmas at Shepperton Studios or wherever it is they shot this thing in London.
Right, yeah.
You know, but nonetheless, he makes an effort to sort of put something in every scene just about.
It was very... I didn't remember it as a Christmas film at all until reading your book, and that was the one that made me go like, eh? I don't know. Is what I call it.
It's like when I bring up Die Hard as one of my favorite Christmas movies.
One of the best.
Which I love that it's featured on the cover of your book.
Oh, hell yeah.
I love that movie because it's one of the few Christmas movies with guns.
Okay, so I'm actually standing here with the host of Popcorn Mafia. I'm here with Grae Drake. And Grae, first of all, how awesome of a guest was I?
On a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the most awesome and 1 just being a little bit awesome, I would actually give you like a 72. Really? That was like
Show. Now here's what's really funny.
I'm not just kissing your ass right now.
We used the term metasturbation on the show, which at some point, I'm not sure if we have, but like this is the height of metasturbation because I was on your podcast and then you're here on the crash aspect. This exactly, hand job. Oh my God.
I know, it's crazy. So it's like, but metasturbation is actually now what I do to myself all the time when my boyfriend's gone.
I don't know, what did we not get to talk about on the show? Because this was a great episode, I thought.
I don't know what we didn't cover. Like, I feel like we kind of, we really made it on every level.
Is there a Christmas movie that didn't make it in that you wanted to get inside your podcast? Fuck, so distracting. People are doing things to me. Sorry.
We covered every movie. I mean, I usually go on and on about Love Actually, but I feel like I didn't do that this time.
Please don't, though. Love Actually.
That's an amazing movie.
Oh, my God.
Movie.
I am a... You know what? I'm gonna be
honest. Colin Firth speaks terrible Portuguese.
If you see my tree, which is right behind us, I'm a Rankin Bass guy.
You are.
Rankin Bass. I'm a Rankin
Jimmy
Bass.
Jimmy Durante. Like, do your Jimmy Durante impersonation. Oh. It's famous.
Nobody wants a Charlie in the Box.
Okay, honey.
That's my Charlie in the Box imitation.
I said Jimmy Durante.
I was thinking of Island of Misfit Toys.
You don't listen.
Oh, my God. All right.
All right. And well, now back to my podcast. Thanks.
So, that's what's great about Nightmare Before Christmas is that it fulfills two great holidays. I mean, Halloween is the greatest holiday on the planet because, A, no relatives. so there's no drama, right? And B, drinking and slutty outfits on women is encouraged. So for me, Halloween is my favorite holiday of the year. Thanksgiving. And then there's Christmas. You get stuff. Although I'm not, I love to be a present giver. I'm not really good at receiving presents. Mm. So,
symbolism anyone?
He's a present top.
Yes. You nailed it. You nailed me, so to speak. Nightmare Before Christmas is probably one of my favorites. And Christmas movies, I definitely Batman Returns is also a Christmas movie.
Oh, yeah, that's
also
true.
Also in my heist chapter.
Yes, and just sort of... But what I love about a film like Batman Returns and what Tim Burton did with his original incarnation, which you look back on those movies, they're kind of quaint in light of Christopher Nolan's vision for a more realistic Batman.
Totally different apples and oranges. Can't compare them.
Right, but what I do love that Burton did was the design. I mean, he really made fetish clothes acceptable. I love anything where something like that leaks into the mainstream. I once, in an old issue of Film Threat magazine, I had a dominatrix review the film Planet of the Apes. Because the original Planet of the Apes movie is like a Marquis de Sade novel brought to life. It's you know, monkeys. Charlton Heston being stripped naked, thrown into a cage, bound with a leather collar, and forced to have sex with some native woman. He's Dr. Zaius isn't just tied to a rock. He's bound to a rock in a bizarre way that you'd only know how to do if you had read The Art of Japanese Rope Bondage.
Or you were an admiral in the British Navy.
Precisely, but if you look at
same
that,
difference.
There's so many instances. I mean, the humans are really treated as livestock, which is right out of, you know, any S&M fiction.
Sexy.
It's just if you're familiar with that world.
Make me sleep on the hay and eat out of the bowl on the floor.
Right.
How weird is it that Planet of the Apes is sexier than Eyes Wide Shut?
But it's only that's funny. But it's only that first movie. The other films in the series, they just sort of go into. It turns into a blaxploitation genre by Battle for the Planet of the Apes. But that very first movie, and that's why I appreciate your book, Alonso, because you're giving people a new way of looking at a film that they're already familiar with, which gives you like little kernels of enjoyment. It's like, here are the Easter eggs that I'm pointing out for you. So
thank you.
I applaud that.
Thank you.
Yes.
Bravo.
Buy that book. Buy it. Can I see that actually? Because there are a couple.
Thank you.
There are a couple in there. I forgot my copy that I had marked as being ones that I hadn't seen. Oh yes, The Lion in Winter.
Oh yeah.
I haven't seen that one. Or Metropolitan. Those are both in your...
Metropolitan is so great. See,
Christmas
now that's,
movies for grown-ups chapter.
Now, that's Metropolitan is a movie. That's what I'm saying with Eyes Wide Shut. Like, the difference of not shooting in real New York.
Mm.
Like, Whit Stillman, first film, made it super cheap. But rather than make, like, a super kind of grimy indie film, he shot in New York at Christmas time. And as he says in, like, his notes, like, I got millions of dollars worth of free art direction.
Right.
You know, and so it's like... Once you've got the kids in the tuxedos, the rest is the city is giving you.
It's just so magical. You know, last year was the first time that I've been in New York for the holiday.
Oh, no, me too. Me too.
Yeah, and it was just like, have you seen it, Chris? Because it's stunning.
Wow. No.
It's really gorgeous. It's like
I'm going this year, actually.
Really good. Because it's like all of that stuff, the Rockefeller Center tree.
The store windows. And
it's so good.
The Rockefeller Center tree is... It's huger than it looks on TV, but the skating rink is much smaller than it looks on TV.
Yeah, it's a weird... You're right about that, actually. And they've replaced the lights with LEDs now, so it looks like a huge Christmas spaceship that just landed on 30 Rock. It's great.
No, I love Christmas in New York, and I have to say, I'm not a big Disneyland person, but I love going to Disneyland at Christmas time.
It's so good.
With the insanely steroidal Christmas trees and the Nightmare Before Christmas in the Haunted Mansion. It's a Small World with the thing and the fireworks and the fake snow and the I'm in for all of that.
I know. Mm. It makes me I didn't this year get my Disneyland pass for the year. I decided not to. And it's this time of year that makes me feel like that's a huge mistake. Because I love going and I love just sitting back and just drinking in the tinsel. It looks like an elf shack.
Drinking is good, too.
Also drinking.
It's Christmas crack is what I always call it. and you're mainlining it at Disneyland.
It definitely is. It's so. Are you a big Disneyland person? Do you? You seem like the kind of person that would take serious drugs and go there. Not like that's a bad thing. No drugs.
Not recently. No, I haven't been to Disneyland in a long time. No.
Yeah, you gotta go. Like it's.
Yeah, if you like decorating your house with Nightmare Before Christmas, you have to see the Haunted Mansion.
It's spectacular.
That's really amazing.
I still have not seen it. I'm dying to see
it. It's marvelous. It's really. It actually makes regular Disneyland pale in comparison. Much like decorating your home for Christmas makes it look barren the rest of the year.
Yeah, I pretty much only go to Disneyland in December, with rare exceptions like if my niece is in town or something.
That makes.
But beyond that, I go Christmas and I'm good for the year.
When is the day that it's sort of like known as like where all the gay people go?
Oh, like gay day?
Gay day. I want to go on gay day, which would be
fun. See, I don't.
Why?
Because gay people annoy me. En masse, anyway. One-on-one, they're fine.
I just enjoy being checked out well, by the same sex.
All that, honestly.
It gives me a confidence. They're checking out my cock.
Because you're a tease. You're not going to deliver. You just want to be ogled.
All that high-pitched screaming on Space Mountain. Jesus Christ.
I just worry about it's in August. I think it's October, actually.
Oh, is it?
But I'm not sure on this.
I think maybe I'm thinking of Goth Day.
Oh, that's a whole, yeah, Goth Day at Disneyland. I've never been to that. I hear it's amazing.
With such a cruel scheduling of Goth Day in August.
Yes. Can we do Goth Gay Day? That would be awesome. I want to go then.
Both of them will be there. I don't think that Venn diagram really overlaps a whole lot.
I'm really disappointed, Alonso. I mean, this is disappointing me. Next you're going to tell me you don't have any Judy Garland records.
Oh, honey, don't worry
about that. Wow, we are trafficking in some ancient stereotypes. That's true.
But we did have kind of a tiff over on Twitter, which is a minor tiff. Because I was mainly
goofing on you. I don't even remember what it was about now.
I think it was the
Twilight is Gay t-shirt.
Right, yes.
Which, because here's the thing, I don't like it when people use gay as stupid, and I certainly don't want Twilight being called gay. Because, frankly, we don't want to claim that shit either.
It is pretty, it's far from being gay.
But it turned into a good DM discussion.
It was, yes. We opened a good dialogue.
We DM'd each other. It was great.
Hot DM action.
Totally gave Alonso a DM. Mm. Several DMs.
Sexiest episode ever.
In front of everybody. And then we ate from the buffet.
Love it.
Now, okay, what are Chris, because I know you have an encyclopedia of obscure and oddball film choices. What are some of your favorite kind of off-kilter Christmas flicks?
Well, God, I mean, I've already brought up a whole bunch. I mean, Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, which is actually on your cover, is one of my favorites from when I was a kid because I love science fiction growing up. And then Christmas is also, it's a delightful holiday when you're in the single digits, when you still believe in things like Santa Claus. So I love that movie. But what's so weird about looking at that film now, it's bizarre because I didn't realize it's all dubbed. It's a foreign film. It's terribly made, the production value.
Wait, are you
Santa Claus Conquers the Martians?
Right. No, it's American. I think it was just maybe the sound.
Maybe it was
bad.
The bad ADR.
Yeah.
But I remember loving that movie as a kid because it kind of fulfilled two great interests: my love of sci-fi and love of the holidays.
One of Alonzo's fun facts being shot in just 10 days for a budget of less than $200,000.
Wow, I did not.
And
know
it
that.
Shows.
Yeah, well, it
to
does
quote
show.
The book,
it does show.
Now, what's great about Santa Claus Conquers the Martians? There are very funny riff versions of it by both Mystery Science Theater and Cinematic Titanic.
Oh wow!
Really?
And in fact, Cinematic Titanic, their thing was, we're going to do Santa Claus Conquers the Martians, and we're not going to repeat any of the jokes that we did on Mystery Science Theater. So there's two completely separate ones that are hilarious that make that movie worth sitting through.
Those guys are great.
Yeah.
Have
you seen the Mexican Santa Claus?
Santa Claus?
No, I haven't.
Oh.
I have not.
Chris, you need to see this.
That was last year's holiday episode of The Mafia where Alonzo and Dave White and I discussed this film. It is bonkers.
Santa and Merlin team up to fight Satan.
I love it already.
Are there
luchadors?
No, but it is from the director of Wrestling Women versus the Aztec Mummy. So you know you're in good hands.
Oh, my God. That's
and
awesome.
And we were just discussing before you came in, just released on Blu-ray. You're welcome.
Oh,
I think it's coming out like next week on Blu-ray. Yeah, so it's stunning.
Amazing. I'm trying this year to watch things that I've never watched before. And a recommendation from Mr. Dave White is This Christmas.
Oh, I'm a fan of that one.
This Christmas?
This Christmas.
And you just have to put out of your mind everything you know about Chris Brown.
Oh.
Because he plays a very sweet young boy in this movie.
Yeah. So it's a very, it's this African-American Christmas. It's like the Tyler Perry movie, but good.
Yeah. It's more like Jumping the Broom than a Tyler Perry
movie. Yeah. I love Jumping the Broom.
Wait, what happened to Kwanzaa?
There are no Kwanzaa movies that I know of, but I'm sure somebody out there, you know, a very Madea Kwanzaa can't be that far away.
Let's hope. They got to represent.
I got the DVD of A Madea Christmas, the play, which means hopefully the movie will be happening at some point.
Wait a second. You've watched one of those Tyler Perry movies? Because just from seeing the trailers.
Honey, this is what we do for a living.
Yeah, no shit.
We don't have a choice. I've seen a lot of Tyler Perry. Dave's seen every single Tyler Perry movie.
Well,
and he likes them.
Can you tell me something redeeming about them?
Madea's funny.
Medea is funny, as actually. A character. Yeah, I mean, a little of her can go a long way, but she is funny. And Tyler Perry does give jobs to underemployed black actresses. So, you know, like you watch Meet the Browns and you get an Angela Bassett performance, you know.
Yeah. And I've heard some majorly questionable behaviors towards WGA writers from Tyler Perry. Like, yeah. He's not really beloved by people. However, I mean, he makes
There's a lot wrong with his movies, don't get me wrong.
Well, yeah, but it's like, why is nobody making movies for this particular audience that are good? You know, and so at least Tyler Perry's trying, because a lot of people go see his plays, and that's what got him started.
Yeah,
so
I mean,
it makes you laugh occasionally.
It's like if you were a gay guy in the early 90s, you would go see any movie that came your way that was remotely gay, because there was just nothing out there.
Right.
And were you a gay guy in the early 90s?
I was indeed. Yes.
All right. Well, then you are speaking from experience.
Having been there, having been around that block a time or two. No, so it's like, you know, I mean, and that's not even necessarily about seeing bad movies, like Poison. Todd Haynes' Poison was a big hit in 1991 for a lot of people who would have never in a million years gone to see like a very experimental, difficult art film, which it is, because it was gay and there was just nothing else.
What about Greg Araki films?
Yeah, those too.
Or John Waters. Like, to me, like, I just loved movies that had gay themes just because they were not traditional. And John Waters was really my gateway drug to all of that stuff. Like Pink Flamingos, Female Trouble. I mean, I fell in love with John Waters. And so that was, I would seek that stuff out because it was just, I mean, the mainstream stuff is so cliche after a while. It's like, I've seen that movie, Cookie Cutter, a million times.
Yeah, and then to see Divine eating shit off the sidewalk is quite exciting.
Oh my god,
for sure.
Yes.
And that's really
not to Hollywood.
And that's not even one of the best movies moments. Excuse me, from his films. Like, John Waters is a
right,
ton
but
of fun,
anyway, what I'm saying though is like there were a lot of very mediocre gay movies that came out in the 90s, and they got
or
an audience.
Too serious, or they're too deadly
yeah,
serious.
Because
and
but you have
like Sundance movies.
Sure, but what I'm saying is if you have an audience that is being underserved, they will go see whatever.
Right.
So like Tyler Perry movies do really well. Because that audience isn't getting a lot of stuff that's aimed at them. And I think that if you had a better filmmaker who could make movies that were that appealing, you know, that would be nice. But in the meantime, we have Tyler Perry, and so that's why.
Or, if I might recommend, Ticked Off Trannies with Knives is also a great – you know what I'm talking about?
I know of it. I've never seen it.
It's great. It's basically these transvestites that are harassed by, you know, guys out to beat up some fags, so to speak, and they get their revenge in the most vile possible way imaginable, like right out of a trauma movie, very graphic. But it's awesome. You're cheering for them.
You're into it.
Yeah, the title is The Pitch. It's pretty much right. All right.
That's
there.
All you need to know.
Yeah. So I recommend that too.
And actually, John Waters, the only movie that appears in my first book, 101 Must-See Movies for Gay Men, and Have Yourself a Movie Little Christmas, is Female Trouble.
Female Trouble, yes. The opening scene at Christmas.
Yeah.
Cha-cha heels. Oh, my God.
It's the only Christmas scene in the book, but it's so indelible that I couldn't not include it. So.
Right. Absolutely.
I remember that blew me away. I saw that when I was 16 and at the theater, and it was so awesome, a rep theater, seeing Female Trouble. That scene is amazing.
I remember that I used to gauge how good a friend I had if I could say to them, if they were like, how was your Christmas? And I'd be like, I didn't get a pair of cha-cha heels. If they knew what I was talking about, then they were like
they
moved
stay.
Up on the list.
Oh, my God. That's
yeah.
Great.
Movie snob. So... I'm so excited for the holiday though. I'm totally in the mood. Thanksgiving was wonderful, and now it's all just a downward slope from here. Can you believe the year's almost over?
It's crazy. I
2011.
I was just barely wrapping my mind around it, and it's going to be 2012.
Yeah, the last year of our existence, according to the Mayans. Yeah. But also,
although wait, I don't know if I told you this story about 2012.
I don't know.
I went to the junket for 2012.
Mm-hmm.
Which
no.
We're talking about the John Cusack movie, Roland Emmerich, sort of horrible. You know, you remember the trailer with these visions of California falling into the ocean and just things blowing up and continents.
which got cheers at the LA press screening, which is kind of perverse.
But it's great because you recognize, there's my house going down into the water. But I love the just horrible images of destruction and disaster and whatnot.
Entertainment.
We were flown to a junket where we were. we got to go to a panel of 2012 experts in which each of them gave their theory. Three 2012 experts gave their theory as to why, what the Mayans meant by okay. ending the calendar, and what it all meant. And some said that, yes, the world's going to end. Another guy said, well, we're going to have solar flares. It's going to be like a giant EMP, and we're going to have a new renaissance because we're not going to be looking at our screens anymore. Everyone had a different theory. At the very end of the panel, I raised my hand and I said, let me ask a question. Is it possible that Nostradamus, the Mayans, anyone who had seen things in the future, is it possible that they may have just seen the trailer for 2012 in their mind's eye and by seeing that predicted the end of the world? Which got a burst of laughter, and the people on the 2012 panel were pissed off, except for one guy.
How dare you not take this seriously?
One guy who came up to me and said, you know, that theory is not far off, because to the primitive mind, if someone with a primitive mind had seen a trailer for a movie back then, you actually just physically showed them the trailer, they wouldn't have no comprehension of what it is that they were seeing.
Sure.
Which devolved into a conversation about what if we went back into early colonial America and showed them Star Wars? Just from from an anthropological standpoint, how would they see it?
They would lose their goddamn mind.
Yeah, and so it was great. He actually said, well, it's interesting. They would see Darth Vader as Satan, Luke would be Jesus, and so he sort of broke it apart as to how the, you know, early American brain would process seeing something like the original Star Wars, not the special edition. Fuck that.
That's wow.
I was wondering why Thomas Jefferson wrote about Greedo shooting first.
All right, so I think I finally got Rick Chris Rack. I've mentally tethered him so he can actually sit here. Yeah, we're doing a podcast. And we're doing our
Christmas podcast.
Yes, well, this is, first of all, it was a great episode of Popcorn Mafia. Follow at Popcorn Mafia or go to popcornmafia.com. Follow my friend, Grae Drake. She's kind of hot. And follow the show at PodCRASH Show. Thank you for listening. Have a happy holiday. I appreciate you tolerating my loud party. And I have one last thing to say to everyone here. Let's get out of here!
She's at the cops.
Asshole.
Enough jokes.
You made a pretty good cowboy yourself, Hans.
Oh, yeah. What was it you said to me before? Yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker.
Happy trails, Hans.
Hey, if you're like me, then you're probably the kind of person who stays to the end credits of a movie and looks at every single name. I like you. We're very much the same. And for that you shall be rewarded. Consider this a little Easter egg. The first person to email me through my website at chrisgore.com, put in the body of the email, give me a free DVD, Gore, and guess what? I will. Of course, the DVD will be of my choice, and it might be something good, it might be something really awful, but it'll be in the pile of DVDs I have for review and something I don't need and or want anymore. And it's yours for free. So, send me that email through my website, chrisgore.com. Also, if you send me a self-addressed stamped envelope to That Chris Gore, 5042 Wilshire Boulevard, PMB 1500,
Los Angeles, California, 90036. I will return said self-addressed stamped envelope with a surprise. And I know you love surprises. Later.